A 10-year-old boy met with a devastating car accident in which he lost his left arm. In a bid to build confidence in the boy, his mother decided to register the boy for judo classes. Now, the boy began lessons with an old Japanese judo master. The boy was doing well, so he couldn't understand why, after 3 months of training, the master had taught him only one single move. Sensei, the boy, out of frustration, said, "Shouldn't I be learning more moves?" The sensei replied, "Just focus on the one move and keep practicing the same move." Not quite understanding, but believing in his teacher, the boy kept training. Several months later, the sensei took the boy to his first tournament. Surprising himself, the boy easily won his first two matches. The third match proved to be more difficult, but after some time, his opponent became impatient and the boy skillfully used one move to win the match. The boy was now in the finals. This time, his opponent was bigger, stronger, and more experienced. For a while, the boy appeared to be overmatched. Concerned that the boy might get hurt, the referee called for timeout. He was about to stop the match when the sensei intervened. "No," the sensei insisted, "let the boy continue." Now, soon after the match started again, his opponent made a critical mistake. He dropped his guard. Instantly, the boy used his move to pin him down. The boy now had won the match and the tournament. He was now the new champion. On the way home, the boy asked his teacher what was playing in his mind. "Sensei, how did I win the tournament with only one move and only one hand? Did the opponent feel pity on me?" The sensei answered, "You won because of two reasons. First, you have mastered one of the most difficult throws in all of judo. And second, the only known defense for that move is for your opponent to grab your left arm, and you do not have the left arm." Friends, winners always identify their weakness, but focus on their strength. While losers identify their strength, but focus on their weakness. Knowing your strength and weakness is the key to a very important door you must open in life, the door to personal growth. In life, we all have to face the fact that we are good at some things, just passable at others, and downright lousy at some. One of the basic questions facing everyone creating a personal development plan is the fundamental question of whether to focus attention on correcting faults, weaknesses, and failings, or to focus on building strength. For some reason, a lot of experts and gurus think you should focus on what's holding you back, or rather weaknesses. But in my opinion, you need to focus on what you are great at, or your strength. Remember, whatever you focus on expands. So focus on the strengths and manage your weaknesses. It's a tragedy that many people are fixated solely on reporting or repairing their weaknesses and don't have the chance to do what they do best every day. Various studies have shown that when we focus on developing our strengths, we grow faster than when we try to improve our weaknesses. People who focus on their strengths are happier, they are less stressed, and more confident. So if you are finding that you are consistently failing or falling short on the goals you have set for yourself, it may be time to consider trying to improve where you are already strong, rather than focusing your efforts on getting better in an area where you are weak. Friends, the truth is that no matter how hard you work on certain weaknesses, the chances are you'll always make only marginal progress. Don't waste too much of time overcoming flaws. Better to focus on what you do best. The choice is between multiplication of results using strength or slight improvement fixing weaknesses that will at best become mediocre. Focus on better use of your best weapons instead of constant repair. In the book, Talent is Never Enough by John Maxwell, he felt that people should stop working on their weaknesses but focus on their strengths. he felt one should not waste his time working on his weaknesses because you are already weak in it, but rather use your strength to enhance your performance. Understand, people don't pay you for average. People pay you for excellence. It was observed that people can increase their ability in any area by only 2 points on a scale of 1 to 10. So if your natural ability in an area, let's say in mathematics or in music, is about 4, with hard work, you may rise to 6. But let's say you have a natural talent in an art or literature where you are 7, then you have the potential to be 9 or even a full 10 if it's your greatest area of strength and you work exceptionally hard at it. What I'm trying to say is, let's say when we were back in school, you were very good in literature or in language, but weak in mathematics. Your teacher will invariably tell you to concentrate in mathematics and the subject that you are weak. And what really happens is that you marginally improve with effort in mathematics and your entire performance in literature now begins to suffer. Some people believe that their weakness will be lost over time, but their strengths are there to stay. This is a misconception, because believing that the weakness will be lost over time and strength stays with us, it might lead us to a feeling of lack of motivation to work on our strength. Neglecting areas of strength and failing to work on the good things we already have could overlook the source of happiness. Working on a weakness can become frustrating and may even lead to withdrawal. Highly successful people are not void of weaknesses, but their capacity to gain from their strength is what propels them to accomplish great things in life. The problem with most people not being able to give in their best boils down to wrong identification of a strength and a weakness. In the book, Go Put Your Strength to Work by Marcus Buckingham, says that we often identify our strengths and weaknesses in the wrong way. We think of strengths as things we are good at and weaknesses as things we are bad at. But a better way to think of strengths and weaknesses, according to the author, is to figure out what energizes us. Strengths make us feel strong, weaknesses make us feel weak. So he says, one way to identify your strength is to think about how activities make you feel. Something is a strength if you are drawn to it, even if you don't know why. If it fully engages you when you're doing it, and you often find yourself in a flow state, and on completion of an activity, you feel energized, fulfilled, and powerful. It is definitely possible to be good at something you hate doing, but that's not the type of strength you necessarily want to improve. Instead, think of the things that energize and excite you, even if you don't excel at them yet. Those may be the strengths you set out to develop and grow. Friends, only you can take yourself to where you want to go, but not without the right mindset. Remember, focusing on your weakness won't get you to great success. Instead, identify your strengths, build systems to improve those strengths, and allow those strengths to grow. Then you can truly realize your full potential.